First of all, it's great to be back to Waterloo. And second, thank you, Edu, Akim, and Rob for organizing this great thing. I am not sure which number of RQI it is, but it's good to be here, and it's good to see more and more people coming to it. So today, I'd like to talk about a couple of things. Some of them are relatively old, but maybe I even should have known them a long time before. And I'll try to share these things with you. So it's spin operators, localization, and uncertainty relations for relativistic fermions. First, let's start with motivation. So localization is sort of an embarrassing topic in relativity. Yes, localized and spin-dependent events and detections, they are the experimental basis of quantum field theory in particle physics and quantum optics. On the other hand, we do have sort of problems, or at least issues, if we try to characterize localization. And part of my work for the last few years was trying to understand this picture better. So as you can see, as a cartoonish reasons, I provided the first Stern-Gerlach experiment, one of the recent CERN high energy experiments, and using tracking electron dynamics with femtosecond lasers. Additional, probably true reason for all this, I eventually want to understand how to couple spin and gravity, both with standard gravity and with exotic models. And there is quite a lot of controversy. So to avoid it, we need to go to basics and figure out how things really work. So we have three goals. I'd like to have a relativistic analog of non-relativistic probability density, psi squared. I think I understand it reasonably well for photons. Now I would like to have the same thing for fermions. Immediately related question, what are the uncertainty relations? How close can we go to delta x, delta p, whatever defined relative to h bar? And I know that there are tons of spin operators. Till last year, I just didn't realize how many. Again, I would like to understand why there are so many and what to do with them. So just to scare you, please don't try to read the small prints. It's just a useful table from this paper, 7 reasonable spin operators with some of their properties. We'll get to know some of them slightly better later. My first impression when I looked at this table was, why? I would like to understand it, and I hope that you will agree with some of my understandings. And as in my old talks, I have to give some warnings. First of all, a particle is what is detected by a particle detector. The snappiest quote is from Bill Andrew. Typically, I give a picture of Bill with this situation, but since he is in the audience, I think we can just look at him. We have to be careful, really, with the idea of what is a particle, because the very nature of transition from particle to wave and back, wave-particle duality in all its aspects, is very fluid. We can actually first perform detection and only afterwards decide, or actually detect, whether what was detected was test for particle properties or for wave properties. So particle is not an absolute concept. It's just something which is very pragmatic. But since those descriptions exist, I want to have a mathematically unambiguous description of this process. Losing as many things as it happens in the way, but at least what is left is mathematically unambiguous. I know there will going to be uncertainty. That's fine. I just want to have a good handle on what this uncertainty is. And the units, C equals H bar equals 1 for most of the cases. As always, I try to avoid 1 equals E equals pi equals 2, but it's not guaranteed. Metric, we're working today only with flat Minkowski space-time. Time-time component is a minus 1. A little bit more about conventions. I don't have to make an admission. Maybe it's a problem of my education. I don't trust interpretations of Dirac equations. If I cannot write this thing with creation annihilation operators in proper Hilbert space, I don't believe in it. So I will use more field theoretical language maybe than necessary, but at least it makes me slightly more comfortable. You know, babies need pacifiers. I need creation annihilation operators. Okay, but then we need to talk about conventions. Here they are. We define states of definite momentum as spin by performing the standard boost from the rest frame and spin, rest frame spin there. General momentum eigenstates transform unitarily, where D is a representation for spin 1/2 particles, just SU2 matrix, of a Wigner transformation, Wigner little group element. For massive particles, it's a rotation. And we write field with creation and annihilation operators for particles and antiparticles, and we're dealing with Dirac fermions. So UP and VP are positive and negative energy solutions. We'll talk about their conventions a bit later. All right, Lorentz invariant measure also represented here. So the outline. We'll talk about spins and positions, how they're related and why there are so many, possibly. Then several useful relationships between the spins and one invariant. I don't know what to do with it, but I'll show it to you and maybe we'll figure it out. Then we'll briefly revise localization. Again, after Juan León's talk this morning, and it becomes tradition, it's, I think, a second RQI where Juan gives a talk about general aspects of localization in the morning, and I give about particular aspects in the afternoon. Very convenient. So it will be just one slide unless you want to talk more about it. Then we'll talk about two popular positions, so position POVMs that I would describe for localization. And we'll talk about the similarities and differences, move to uncertainty relations, and summary and what's going on. So the question, why so many? And for here, we need to go to history a little bit, or at least back to basics. If we talk about non-relativistic quantum mechanics and we want to discuss dynamics of spinning particle, we have Schrödinger-Pauli equation. Here, both position and momentum are dynamical variables. They're part of the Hamiltonian, and they're observables, and we sort of know what to do with them. And spin, represented by Pauli matrix, well, 1/2 h bar, but okay, h bar is 1, 1/2 is 1, so it's Pauli matrix. It's also a dynamical variable. It's part of the Hamiltonian, and this is the spin observable. That's our set of quantum prejudices. That's what we expect. How this is how we would like observables, even in the relativistic domain, to be fashioned. Life is not fair, or at least maybe at least fun. If we talk about field theory, this is part of Hamiltonian of Lagrangian of the standard model. We don't have position, momentum, and spin as dynamical variables. At the best, we have Pauli matrices or SU3 matrices as part of just writing things, and the rest are fields and their interactions. So we have to generate our observables in some sort of effective way, emergent way, if you want to use more fancy words. More specifically, if we talk about momentum, then we get it from symmetry considerations, say, work by Wigner, popularized by Weinberg and many other people. We used momentum to label one particle free state. So, okay, fine. Spin comes together with momentum very often, so symmetry considerations, free, again, label for free one particle states. Pretty good. There are practical considerations how particle physicists actually characterize spin. So the story becomes slightly murkier, and position is just an embarrassment. Many textbooks even avoid talking about position at all, and if they talk, it's somewhat like Victorians and sex. So happens to animals, but not discussed in literature. And if we talk about dynamical variables, for example, models in nuclear physics, interaction depending on spin on the nucleons. So go to effective field theory, like Carl field effective field theory, looks horrible. At the end, you get low energy limit. You get your interactions involving spin. More precisely, involving Pauli matrices. Since it's low energy, Pauli matrix is spin. Or we take various limits, for example, for Dirac equation. So that's a long and rather painful process. And the concept of observable and the concept of dynamical variable are not necessarily one and the same, not something that we used in non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So let's talk about spin. I have to serve you yet another serving of conventions. So if we stick to Dirac equation, basically alpha and beta and Dirac gamma matrices, Dirac spin in the standard representation is 4x4 matrix with two powerless on the main diagonal. And the total angular momentum is a combination of Dirac spin. And then our angular total angular momentum, conserved quantity, simple position, simple momentum, Dirac spin. Good. So let's go and look again at those seven operators. And one formula. So we can understand part of the origin, why we have so many, because every time somebody proposes position operator, assuming that momentum is sort of uncontroversial, we get another spin operator. Every time somebody proposes spin operator, you automatically assume, at least in the Dirac picture, you're getting position operator. So here are the spin operators. There are matching position operators practically to all of them. So what we'll talk is this thing. Now, the upper line is the Dirac spin. The lower line is my favorite, let's say, standard object of say Wigner and many textbooks. That's the rest frame of Wigner spin. Just using Dirac notation, it looks so ugly. And by accident, we'll deal with yet another spin operator, which is spin operator popularized by Marek Shahor, with which he showed that even the question whether Bell inequalities are violated or not in the relativistic regime depends on which spin operator you are using. And for this particular one, they're not violated. Okay, now let's get four objects. So four polarization, take one. We start from non-relativistic expression for spin or for non-relativistic expression for polarization vector. Declare them to be spatial components of a four vector in the rest frame. Perform the standard Lorentz transformation and get four polarization vector. This vector has a number of useful properties. It's orthogonal to the momentum. Its square is just, okay, in our signature, it's minus square of the rest frame spin. And its time component naturally easily related to the space components. Okay, take two. A proper group theoretical treatment of of particles. Representation of the Poincaré group labeled by two Casimir invariants. One is mass squared and one is square of the Pauli-Lubansky operator. If we write the Pauli-Lubansky operator in the component form, we can write its time component as a scalar product between momentum and angular momentum, and its spatial components are slightly uglier, but not by much. If we put a request, list of reasonable axioms, what the spin operator should satisfy, that in the rest frame it's just the usual non-relativistic spin, it's a three vector, and its components satisfy normal spin commutation relations, and as a technical requirement, it's linear in Pauli-Lubansky, we get what is often called the Wigner spin or Price spin, the rest frame spin. That's how often we label states in particle physics, probably in half of the cases, and that's my preferred object. With a little bit of thought, and to my embarrassment, I gave this thought only recently, we can see that four spin is just Pauli-Lubansky divided by mass. It's sort of pretty evident once you look at two different sets of formulas. For some reason, different books prepare different articles follow either one way of discussing things or another, and somehow never bother to mention it. Still my fault. Now, how we turn it into expectation values? Wigner spin, as I told you, I don't trust things unless I can write them with creation and annihilation operators, has a pretty neat structure. Operator creation, annihilation, particles, antiparticles, measure, just direct product with standard Pauli. Dirac spin, just stick it in the middle, write the fields, take the normal order. Obviously, they're different. Taking, for example, a state with sharp momentum, to which we can associate Dirac spinners. Their prescription is unambiguous. I just don't bother to describe it in detail because it's so lengthy. We get two expressions for the Dirac spin and for the Wigner spin. One is pretty natural, second maybe slightly less expected, but still pretty easy to work with. If we're interested in helicity, we get the same expression in both cases. There are a couple of interesting consequences. Obviously, we can express any spin operator expectation values of this operator in terms of expectation values of any other spin operator. So that's one of the hints that probably the question, which is a true spin operator, at least when we deal with momentum eigenstate, is rather mute. It's just a question, what is conveniently, what is the most convenient thing to express your data? We go from one to another. If we think about which operator can we prepare, I mean, for which operator we can prepare our eigenstates, oh yes, then probably Wigner or rest frame spin beats others, but it's a question of it's value judgment. It's not physics or math. If we discuss how spin couples to other degrees of freedom, we try to discuss Stern-Gerlach experiment, for example, with relativistic particles. If you really want to, you can start to work with the rest frame spin, but it's much more convenient to begin with four polarization and then go to rest frame spin. So yes, different operators conveniently used for different purposes. Going to one particle state kills some of the properties. Dirac spins commute in a standard way. Once you reduce them as operators on one particle Hilbert space, they don't. You lose the nice properties of eigenvalues and so on. But again, whether it's good enough or bad enough to call it spin operator or not to call it spin operator, it's more matter of taste than if anything else. But now let's look for covariance and some invariant quantity. So for a long time, from 1950s, work I think Louis Michel and Whiteman, there is a 4x4 polarization density matrix for spin. So we're using Dirac spinners, and there is also its analog for the antiparticles. Obviously cannot avoid using gamma matrices, but it conveys essentially the same information as our favorite 2x2 density matrices and Wigner spin. We've seen in the previous slide how we can go from one to another. The story becomes slightly more interesting, and actually probably much more interesting, if we look not at the momentum eigenstates, which are after all not physical, but to wave packets, where we characterize, we have a momentum space wave function with different momentum, different spin components. Then we can calculate a reduced density matrix for spin, and we know pretty well that this reduced density matrix is not covariant. So if it's not a rotation but a boost, if you got rid of the momentum, you don't know what to do with it and how to transform it from one absorber to another. And that means spin entropy is not a Lorentz invariant quantity. On the other hand, if we generalize the spinorial density matrix, then life is still easy. Spinners still transform according to finite dimensional non-unitary representation. So there is no problem with the transformation law for this reduced density matrix. Then there is no problem with the transformation law for the expectation value of the spin. You just calculated it, took weighted average, and still if you do an arbitrary Lorentz transformation, all you need to do is to apply this Lorentz transformation. So we even have an invariant quantity. Expectation value squared. Okay, what does it mean? Here are two answers. So one is positive, one is negative. One is positive, we've got something invariant, something that characterizes the state. Maybe it characterizes momentum spin entanglement in the state. So we just have to play. That's something that I'm planning to do, to play with different states and see how this quantity depends on, say, momentum spin entanglement in one particular frame. Maybe it's some average of what we can extract. So it gives us some opportunity. Now, whether it's really useful quantity, not as a characterization of state, but as a predictor of what we're going to see in the experiment? No. We need to couple spin to other degrees of freedom to get, for example, Stern-Gerlach experiment. If we ignore the momentum, we cannot do it. So we are not going to get wiser prediction-wise by switching from Wigner's spin to the four spin. But we gained an invariant quantity, and this is something that we should investigate. Okay, obviously there are more stories about spin, but it's time to change tack and switch to localization. So localization-wise, let's start from a quick review. So what's the problem? We can try to localize things in as events of space-time, which is rather complicated, or slightly simpler, and this is what we are going to do because I'm lazy, to localize things on a time slice. So probability of finding a particle, remember, that means probability of detecting something in a spatial region. Now, Juan went through, enumerate most, I think, or even all obstacles that we have. Some obstacles also psychological. We have expectations of what is particle and how it should behave. Now, what's worse, our forefathers scientifically had classical prejudices. Now we also have quantum mechanical prejudices. We want this to behave as a non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So more constraints, more requirements. But we know that we have to give quite a lot of things that we like if we want to prepare things that we really care about as fundamental, like causality, for example. Again, if we want, we can discuss and have a ton of slides about it, but probably let's get to the business. So out of all possibilities, I'd like to talk about two versions of the position and talk about their similarities and differences. Now again, I prepared a list, a very short list. Thing which is not here at all is a totally different approach to characterizing motion of classical spinning particles pioneered by Tullio Reggio by using the whole matrix of Lorentz transformation, which describes motion and orientation of the reference frame system attached to spin. It has some advantages, some horrible complications, and it's beautiful area that I hope to understand better. But now I would like to discuss more pedestrian quantities. So we have standard position, let's call it X. Then many of those operators go to the paper of Price from 1948. And clarified by work by Newton and Wigner in 1949. So center of energy, then we have some fancy center of energy, which I'm not going to discuss, and what is called price E, or actually Newton-Wigner operator for Dirac particles. Now, analyzing all those operators and localization in general reminds me of a famous Western. Can you guess which one? Oh, well, it's good, bad, and ugly. And it's not, and since it's quantum, everybody is in a superposition. So let's see. Standard position. Bad, because it mixes positive and negative solution, energy solutions. Fix. Project onto positive and energy states separately, add it up. Lovely, looks ugly, and it becomes non-commuting. Okay, what is good about it? That it is associated with traditional Dirac probability current, which is proven to not to conform to the conditions of Heigerfeld theorem that promises you violation of causality, and actually be causal. So, okay, make your choice, gentlemen. Newton-Wigner position, a story is somewhat different. It's good because it's relatively natural. It's a wave function, especially if you're dealing with scalar fields. By design, its component commute. Ugly, because it's ugly, if you try to write it up explicitly. And bad, because it's known that for scalar particles and for Dirac particles, a localization measure, which is based on Newton-Wigner position, will propagate faster than speed of light. And my favorite, operationally justified for light, less so for massive particles, is energy density and normalizations of this energy density. For light, it's obvious because the standard models of photodetection, leading order perturbation theory you do to get detection probability will be proportional to normal ordered combination of, say, electric field operators, which is basically energy density. So let's see what we can get out of this. All right, we're still playing with Dirac thing. We can find that with a little bit of mass that the operator has to depend on spin. We start from energy density, end up with spin. Associated spin operator turns out to be the Chahor spin operator. What's more interesting, and again, I suspect it should have been known for ages, but different books use different approaches. This operator and the projected standard operator are the same. It was news to me. I'm sure that it wasn't news in general. And those are good references about these topics. But now, let's try and get POVMs, positive operator-valued measures that will result in those nice probability distributions, so things that I can trust because they contain creation and annihilation operators. All right, so field theoretical version for POVM, just use bits of fields and you'll be lucky. Of course, you get it as positive and as a measure only if you restrict it to one particle state. We know that if this thing is zero, if expectation is zero on vacuum, it cannot be positive for all states. So if we have stuff like squeeze states, probably we'll get some negative expectations. But we're dealing with spaces with fixed number of particles, and specifically in a space with just one particle, then this thing is even normalized. We calculate the expectation of this POVM element, and we get, surprise, surprise, the square of the Dirac wave function in the position space. Exactly what we wanted, essentially. So this object can be derived from, well, nearly honest to God POVM. And this quantity satisfies what we expect from position. For free particles, if we calculate expectation as a function of time, it's expectation at the initial moment plus velocity, which is defined as ratio of momentum to energy, expectation times time. So this one is good. Now let's see how to get position as center of energy. Here there is a tricky story. We cannot just take the standard energy-momentum tensor, which is used in, say, introducing Lagrangians for Dirac fields, because then if you look at any textbook, say, yeah, and this thing, by the way, it's not Hermitian, but doesn't matter because we get everything right with, even with this quantity. And yes, we get everything right, but if we try to use it to calculate position, we get complex expectation values. So we really need something which is Hermitian and symmetric. So we add total derivative, and this is the symmetric Lagrangian, and, well, missing psi. And this is symmetric energy density. Again, obviously there are standard expressions for all the components. Just more indices, uglier things become, and I'm not putting them on those slides. And what else we'll need? We'll need to normalize things. So we need the Hamiltonian, our energy. We'll need square roots. So on one particle state, all this is well defined. You need power k, the same expression, just took your energy into k's power. And then we can just test basic properties. Rotation, oh, beautiful. We can get current, which will be conserved. Lovely. Proven to be causal, brilliant. An ugly feature is normalization. Again, I'm skipping a long discussion why we stick normalization. Well, basically, it's pretty clear. If we don't stick normalization into POVM, but normalized post factum after the detection, we're losing convexity. Why this is equivalent to just symmetrizing with the inverse Hamiltonians. That's in the work of Bielanicki-Birulas. Taking this, obtaining the final expression, again, reasonably ugly and with nice expectations, we can calculate and we see that P of M through energy density, not very surprisingly, gives the same results as P of M that gives the standard Dirac wave function. So for the same, we have identity of operators in the Dirac picture. So at least we have equivalency of first moments in this picture. Okay, interesting. So probably there is there any difference? Are they the same? So again, looking for this difference, I reminded myself of this dog. The difference is there, and the difference shows up in uncertainty relations. And that's where I will be coming to an end. So first of all, yes, there is a difference between the two. Calculate the second moment. Let's do it just for time zero. That's easier. We have this thing for each component. R is like x squared minus this thingy. Momentum squared divided by energy to the fourth. Okay. It's not that important. It vanishes as in non-relativistic limit, which is good for consistency. And even when it's not, it's like, what, 1 over de Broglie wavelength squared best. But it has a potential to do nasty and interesting things for uncertainty relations. So let's see. Take a Gaussian. I'm not trying to optimize. I'm trying to be lazy. So I absorb as many things which make Fourier transforms complicated as possible into the functions. Take this function to be Gaussian, centered, let's say, on k in x direction, zeros and y in z direction, which is characterized by omega. So that's the variance squared of the momentum. Okay, do the calculation. Calculations are long. Mathematica is great. Life becomes easier. End result. If we look at the product of variances, when we calculate P of M, let's call it Dirac way, we get something which asymptotically goes to the Heisenberg limit 1/4. But if we go for energy P of M, very slightly we go under it. Now in this case, the spread in momentum was 1% of the rest mass, and that's where we've got it. Again, whether it does it mean that it's a bad quantity, I don't know, but that's interesting. All right, so let's summarize. Four spin leads to an invariant quantity. I still have to figure out what to do with it. But choosing which spin operator to work with is mostly a matter of taste. We can get Dirac wave function or something which is very close to it, but not close enough not to break Heisenberg relationships. And, well, in the future, we would like to understand classical limits and spin dynamics. Relativistic spin Stern-Gerlach operators experiment, and not in the easy way, in the proper way, which is actually quite unsharp even in non-relativistic quantum mechanics. If you really look what you measure, then generalize to fancy curved space-times, normal and fancy gravity couplings. Thank you for your attention, and thank you for all those people who helped me to understand aspects of this story. Thank you.